Meiosis is a very special type of cell division. Sorry, mitosis, but I'm gonna argue it's more special than you. You just create exact copies of cells, which is great and all, very crucial for life, but meiosis does a couple extra things that are crucial for sexual reproduction and genetic diversity. Bet you can't do that, mitosis. The cells that result from a meiotic division have half the amount of DNA as the original cell. This allows haploid cells to unite during sexual reproduction to create a diploid zygote. Not only is the amount of DNA different between the original cell and those that result from meiosis, but the DNA sequences themselves are different.
That's because during meiosis, homologous chromosomes undergo a process called crossing over, during which they line up and swap big chunks of themselves around. This results in recombination, or a different combination of genes than those that existed in the original cells, which helps create genetic diversity among offspring during reproduction.
But don't just take my word for it. Today, we're going to witness meiotic recombination in the lab. It's going to be pretty fun.
Gus?
That's right, we are going to use a fungus called Sordaria famicola for our experiment because its life cycle is great for visualizing meiotic recombination.
Picture this.
Two haploid strains of Sordaria are living their best life on a petri dish. One strain is black and the other strain is tan. This color difference is produced by a single gene. The strains are growing and sending out lots of new mycelia or filaments. Pretty soon their mycelia meet and love is in the air. The two haploid strains fuse to produce diploid zygotes, which become surrounded by a structure called a parathecium. Inside the parathecium, the zygotes undergo meiosis. For each diploid zygote that undergoes meiosis, four haploid nuclei are created, which remain lined up together in a bundle which is called an ascus. The nuclei immediately undergo mitosis and develop into spores, so each ascus winds up containing 8 spores. When they're mature, the parathecium will split open and release the spores. They'll go off and grow into mycelia, and the circle of Sordaria life will continue. The spores are what we'll observe today, because they'll either be black or tan like their parents, and their arrangement inside of each ascus is key to understanding recombination during meiosis. Let's start the experiment and I'll show you what I mean. We'll need a culture plate of black and tan Sordaria strains that are getting frisky. You can buy these from biological supply companies, so don't worry about making the plates yourself.
Please note that hand washing is an essential component of both sterile technique and laboratory safety. I washed my hands before handling the Sordaria plate to prevent contamination of the sample.
Forceps or scalpels, a transfer pipette, water, microscope slides and cover slips, a pencil, and a light microscope. I'm going to put a drop of water on my microscope slide and then scrape some parathecia from the Sordaria plate using my scalpel. I'll make sure to scrape where the strains meet on the plate so that I get parathecia that are the result of reproduction between the two. Then I'll transfer the parathecia to the drop of water.
I washed my hands after handling the Sordaria plate to prevent contamination of myself, others in the lab, and the lab environment. When working with your Sordaria sample, you should follow the safety guidelines of your lab and your instructor, who might require additional PPE, such as lab coat, gloves, and goggles.
Next, I'll put a cover slip over the parathecia and gently tap the cover slip with the pencil eraser to squash them and release the asci. Now it's time to observe my slide under the light microscope. Sordaria spores are very small, so I'll need a magnification of around 10 or 20x. Oh, look at all the little asci. Let's find ones that'll be ideal for the experiment. First, avoid asci that are so pale you can't tell if they're tan or black. They're not mature enough to be showing the color trait, so we can't use them. Second, avoid free-floating spores because it's their arrangement within an ascus that's the important data point here. If most of your spores are floating around, it means you tapped too hard with the eraser when preparing the slide and might need to make a new one. Okay, here are some beautiful intact asci with colorful spores. These are ideal for our experiment. But we don't want the ones that are all one color because they represent reproduction within a strain. We only want the asci that have a mix of black and tan spores because they're the result of reproduction between the two strains. Here are some good ones. Now, see how these asci have different arrangements of black and tan spores? Let's take a moment to think about what these represent in terms of recombination during meiosis. Here are the chromosomes of a diploid Sordaria cell that has inherited one chromosome from its black parent and one from its tan parent. The gene that controls color is at the end of the chromosome. If no recombination occurs in this chromosome during meiosis, the resulting nuclei will be neatly lined up as tan-tan-black-black or black-black-tan-tan. Remember, the haploid nuclei immediately undergo mitosis, which results in 8 spores in the ascus. So the final result would be 4 tan and 4 black, or 4 black and 4 tan. We would call an ascus that looks like this a parental type because no crossing over occurred and therefore the spores' chromosomes are identical to either the black or the tan parent. Now I'll give you a minute to predict what arrangement of spores you'd expect to see in the ascus if recombination were to occur during meiosis. What do you think? Here are our chromosomes in a diploid cell again. This time, crossing over occurs, which results in cells with chromosomes that have swapped their chunks that contain the color gene. The resulting ascus will have 8 spores that might be tan-tan-black-black-tan-tan-black-black, for instance. We would call an ascus that looks like this a recombinant type, because the chromosomes have been recombined and are now different from the chromosomes of both parents. What other recombinant type asci would you expect to see? We might see recombinant asci that are black-black-tan-tan-black-black-tan-tan, or tan-tan-black-black-black-black-tan-tan, or even black-black-tan-tan-tan-tan-black-black. Phew! Now that we know the difference between parental type and recombinant type, let's see if we can identify them in the wild. On our microscope slide. Oh, here's a parental type ascus. I can see the 4 tan and 4 black spores lined up in a row there. And here's a recombinant type. Look at those black and tan spores all mixed up like that. And we're not gonna stop there. The frequency of recombination between any two points on a chromosome provides a measure for how far apart those two points are. In genetics lingo, we call this measurement the map distance. In our Sordaria example, the recombination frequency is correlated with how far away the color gene is from the centromere. Amazingly, this means that if we look at a bunch of ASCII and count which are the parental type and which are the recombinant type, we can calculate the map distance between the color gene and the centromere. Let's do it. I'm going to count at least 100 ASCII and score them as either parental type or recombinant type. I'm tallying them in a table as I go to help keep track. And now it's time to calculate the recombination frequency to estimate the map distance between our Sordaria color gene and the centromere. When you typically encounter recombination frequency in class, you'll learn that it's the percentage of recombinants in a population, or the number of recombinants divided by the total population times 100. In the case of Sordaria, and only in the case of Sordaria, to calculate the recombination frequency, we need to do an extra step and divide that percentage by 2 because only half the spores in each ascus are the result of a recombination event. Okay, I'm going to calculate the recombination frequency of my Sordaria population. I had 47 parental type ascii and 53 recombinant type ascii. So that's 53 divided by a total population of 100 times 100, then divide all that by 2. That's 26.5%. 1% recombination equals 1 map unit, so my data indicate that the color gene is 26.5 map units from the centromere. The published map distance for Sordaria is 26 map units, so mine was pretty close. If yours is different, don't worry too much. What factors do you think might have led to the different map distance in your population? It could just be due to randomness. Maybe the sample size wasn't quite big enough and the population wasn't representative of the actual map distance. Or perhaps some environmental factors could have influenced the recombination rate on your particular plate of Sordaria. Well, I hope you enjoyed seeing how these little fun guys can help us understand recombination during meiosis. I'll leave you with a little thought experiment. How much genetic variation would there be if we lived in a world without crossing over?